sponsored by Surfshark VPN. While nuclear power raises fear among many of us, it's considered one of our better options for a reliable, carbon-free future. Alongside small modular reactors, molten salt reactors, or MSRs, that use thorium as a fuel are considered cheaper, cleaner, and safer options to the traditional reactors fueled with highly radioactive elements and can benefit in nuclear energy expansion. With experimental tests scheduled for a thorium reactor in China and US companies developing projects that should be spinning up in the next few years, let's revisit thorium energy in molten salt reactors and when we'll be able to see their impact. Could thorium reactors be a cheaper and safer future for nuclear power? I'm Matt Ferrell. Welcome to Undecided. In 2020, I produced a video on thorium reactors explaining what they are, why people were excited about them, and if they could really be the future of green energy. But at that time, at least here in the US, we hadn't seen significant progress in projects involving molten salt reactors. For example, in 2019, the construction of the experimental power plant for the Traveling Wave Reactor, or TWR, developed by TerraPower, was suspended. That was a significant loss for the company, considering that the cost to demonstrate a reactor like that was about $1 billion, according to the CEO of TerraPower, Chris Levesque. Also, due to the technical and practical challenges of molten salt reactors, Lin-Wen Hu, director of research and irradiation services at MIT's Nuclear Reactor Laboratory, said, "There's still a lot of work to be done in terms of demonstrating molten salt reactor technology, even for uranium-based reactors. Molten salt reactors need to be demonstrated with a uranium fuel cycle before the system can be used for a thorium fuel cycle. Moving toward a thorium fuel cycle has a lot of unknowns." But since then, there's actually been some progress. Before we take a deep dive into recent news on thorium and molten salt reactors, let's quickly review what they are, how they work, and what pros and cons they have. That means getting into the chemical concepts behind the operation of these reactors. Now, you're probably aware that nuclear reactors are responsible for containing and controlling nuclear fission, which is a process where atoms split and release energy in a chain reaction. In short, atoms are bombarded with neutron particles, fissioning the atoms into two smaller atoms and some additional neutrons, and some of those neutrons go on to hit other atoms, and this cycle just keeps on going. Inside the nuclear reactor is a robust steel vessel containing the reactor core, where the fission occurs. It uses a fuel that usually is a radioactive metal like uranium-235 or plutonium-239. Along with the core is a moderator that's usually water or graphite, which is used to reduce the speed of the neutrons coming from the fission process in order to feed the chain reaction. The heat generated by the reaction in the core is used to create steam to turn a turbine and generate electricity. In order to ensure safety in the nuclear reaction, reactors have control systems called rods that speed up or slow down or even stop the nuclear reaction if necessary. The control rods are typically made out of neutron-absorbing materials like silver and boron. If something goes wrong while controlling the nuclear reaction, this can cause the reactor's core to melt down due to excessive heat produced from the chain reaction. And this can be catastrophic, like what happened at Three Mile Island, Chernobyl, or Fukushima. And all of these accidents haven't helped public perception, which has held back interest in pushing nuclear power policy ahead. This is where thorium-fueled reactors have an edge over other nuclear energy technologies. But before I get to that, I'd like to thank Surfshark for sponsoring today's video. I always recommend using a VPN when using public Wi-Fi, but VPNs can be very useful even when you're at home. A lot of online services use some pretty sophisticated commercial targeting and tracking, and a VPN can protect you from that. Surfshark's clean web does a great job blocking ads, trackers, and malicious websites, making it safer to use the internet, even at home. And you can even make it look like your IP address is coming from a completely different country. This can come in handy if you want to stream a video that's only available from a specific location. One of the best parts about Surfshark is that it's easy to set up on all of your devices, whether that's iPhone or Android, Mac or PC. Surfshark is the only VPN to offer one account to use with an unlimited number of devices. Use my code to get 83% off plus 3 extra months for free. Surfshark offers a 30-day money-back guarantee, so there's no risk to try it out for yourself. Link in the description below, and thanks to Surfshark and to all of you for supporting the channel. Now back to where thorium-fueled reactors have an edge over other nuclear technologies. Thorium-fueled reactors offer a potentially safer, cleaner, and more abundant alternative to traditional reactors fueled with highly radioactive elements. Thorium is a naturally occurring, slightly radioactive metal that was isolated back in 1828 by the Swedish chemist Jans Jacob Berzelius. It was 60 years later that the reactive nature of thorium was discovered by Gerhard Schmidt and Marie Curie. Thorium is found in small amounts in most soils and rocks, where it's about 3 times more plentiful than uranium. The most common source of thorium is monazite, a rare earth phosphate mineral that contains up to 12% thorium phosphate. Thorium-232 is the most stable of the 27 thorium isotopes, which decays very slowly. The isotope itself isn't fissile, so it can't be used directly in a thermal neutron reactor. However, when absorbing a neutron, thorium-232 will transmute to thorium-233, which beta decays to protactinium-233. There's a whole chemistry class in here which goes beyond the scope of this video and my brain. But anyway, after thorium-233 beta decays once, it undergoes a second beta decay to become uranium-233, which is an excellent fissile fuel material. This fuel cycle is very important to molten salt reactors because most of the proposed reactors rely on this cyclical process. One big benefit of thorium reactors is the much smaller half-life of the nuclear waste. Uranium-233 can be separated from the thorium, which sets it apart from the uranium-235 and 238. And it's uranium-235 that contains very radioactive isotopes with half-lives of thousands of years. A standard nuclear reactor's waste needs to be stored safely for up to 10,000 years until the isotopes decay. On the flip side, the waste from a thorium reactor is radioactive for about 500 years. Another benefit of thorium breeding uranium-233 is that it can be used in other types of nuclear reactors like heavy water reactors, high-temperature gas-cooled reactors, boiling water reactors, pressure water reactors, and more. Even so, the main reactor type that's being explored for thorium is molten salt reactors. There are many different types of MSRs, including the molten salt breed reactor, which is commercially known as liquid fluoride thorium reactor. While conventional nuclear reactors use solid fuel, LFTRs use a liquid fuel in the form of a very hot fluoride salt that also serves as the coolant, and also operates at low pressure. In these reactors, rather than solid fuel rods, thorium is dissolved into liquid fluoride salt before sending it into the reactor chamber at temperatures above 1,112 degrees Fahrenheit, which is the equivalent to about 600 degrees Celsius. A great benefit of these reactors is that they can self-regulate the process to maintain the temperature within the appropriate range. As the temperature in that reactor goes up, the rate at which the fission reaction occurs goes down. In addition, the liquid fuel is run through a reactor chamber filled with graphite rods that reduce the speed of the neutrons. And if these rods are removed, the chain reaction stops. It's a more reliable emergency braking system than traditional nuclear reactors. Another benefit is the increased fuel efficiency in LFTRs. Because there's no cladding, there's little neutron loss, meaning all the neutrons are used in the reaction, not for crashing into the cladding. This increases the overall efficiency and the life of the fuel. In order to make MSRs even safer, there's a freeze plug safety mechanism built into the reactor plumbing. So if this plug is taken out, the reactor salt goes down the drain, so to speak. Imagine that a nuclear disaster happens and the nuclear power plant undergoes a blackout. The reactor would safely power down without the need for any human intervention. The interest in thorium isn't just for potential safety. Although we don't have a commercial reactor operating currently, it's expected that thorium-fueled reactors will have a lower price than traditional fission reactors. From the economics perspective, thorium-fueled reactors make sense for several key reasons. First, the systems operate at low pressure and high heat capacity, which means that the containment vessels can also be smaller and thinner. Also, thorium-fueled reactors require fewer components for fuel assemblies. They're just basically composed of just vats of fuel, making them simpler and cheaper to build. To make it better, due to their operation at high temperatures, the heat losses are lower, so the efficiency goes up. Finally, while conventional reactors need to be shut down for refueling, LFTRs can be refueled while operating at full power. While there are some major advantages to thorium-fueled reactors, they aren't perfect, and there are several challenges that have been holding them back from mainstream adoption. The main concern with MSRs is that the radioactive fission products could potentially leak from the containment vessels. They are just in a big sealed vat. Traditional reactors keep their fuel in solid pieces surrounded by cladding. On top of that, these plants will require periodic maintenance, but all of the equipment will contain high levels of radioactivity, which can make maintaining the components harder and riskier. Also, there's a proliferation risk because thorium makes uranium-232, which emits gamma rays. This irradiation process can be altered slightly by removing the protactinium-233, forming uranium-233, which could be used in nuclear weapons. Another concern is that while thorium is more plentiful than uranium, it is more expensive to mine. And despite these challenges, the several pros of thorium reactors have resulted in some big projects being developed around the globe. So let's take a look at what's changed since my last video on thorium energy. Some countries like France, India, Japan, Norway, and the US have reported some development on thorium nuclear reactors, but there are no plans for their commercialization just yet. On the other hand, China is closing in on thorium energy. It launched its molten salt reactor program in 2011, investing $500 million. The Chinese government has been developing an experimental reactor based on the MSR technology developed by the researchers at Oak Ridge National Laboratory in the 1950s. Originally designed for aircraft propulsion in the Manhattan Project, the 7.4 megawatt thermal output experimental reactor ran for over 4 years. The project was closed due to corrosion problem and cracked pipes that were caused by the hot salt, as well as weak radioactivity of thorium. These issues made fission reactions unsustainable without adding uranium. China has put modern technology to use with better materials, instrumentation, and controls in order to build its reactor. The experimental prototype generates 2 megawatts thermal output, which is enough to supply about 1,000 homes, and should have started in September of 2021 in the Gobi Desert near the city of Huawei. However, researchers working on the reactor haven't confirmed whether the tests have already started. If the prototype works as designed, China has plans to build a commercial 373 megawatt version by 2030. In the US, the California-based Kairos Power plans to have a 50 megawatt demonstrator reactor operational in Oak Ridge, Tennessee by 2026. The company received $303 million from the US Department of Energy for the design, licensing, and construction of the Hermes low-power demonstrator reactor. Kairos Power's application for building the reactor will go through a review process with federal regulators. The reviews regarding safety and environmental impact should be completed by September of 2023. Also in November of 2021, Southern Company and the Department of Energy came to an agreement on designing, building, and operating the molten chloride reactor experiment, which will push forward the molten chloride fast reactor that's been developed by TerraPower. By the way, TerraPower has announced that it will build its molten salt reactor in Kemmerer, Wyoming, where the coal-fired Naughton Power Plant has been closed. The 345-megawatt reactor has been developed jointly by GE Hitachi Nuclear Energy, combining liquid sodium cooling and molten salt heat storage systems that will better integrate renewable energy. According to the Thorium Reactor Market Research Report, the global thorium market is expected to grow at a rate of about 11.1% between 2021 and 2027. In addition, the global molten salt reactors market is projected to reach about $18.7 billion by 2031, according to Vision Gain Research. When it comes to the levelized cost of electricity, or LCOE, a study published by the International Journal of Sustainable Energy showed an LCOE of a thorium molten salt reactor at $53.51 per megawatt hour with a 30-year lifespan. Comparatively, the study showed a LCOE for a pressurized water reactor, or PWR, at $63.08 per megawatt hour for a 30-year lifespan. So according to the study, thorium-based reactors could be cheaper options among nuclear technologies. There's one added bonus that nuclear energy can bring us, and that was mentioned a lot in my comments on my nanotechnology and water desalination video that I put out just a little while ago, and that's water desalination. The heat generated by nuclear power plants combined with electricity can be used for water desalination, which means removing salt and minerals from seawater and turning into potable water. Because molten salt reactors don't use water to cool down the core, they don't need a large water supply to run. Aquacraft and Terrestrial Energy made a study for the Kingdom of Jordan in order to build an MSR power plant that could produce 6.3 million megawatt hours of electrical energy and 112,000 acre-feet of water, or about 137 million cubic meters. So it sounds like thorium might be a win, but do we really need nuclear power to build a renewable energy future? When compared to solar and wind, nuclear energy is still more expensive. The levelized costs of new generation resources in the annual energy outlook for 2021 from the EIA showed that for new resources entering service in 2026, onshore wind had an LCOE of $31.45 per megawatt hour, while solar was at $29.04 per megawatt hour without energy storage. With a 4-hour battery system, the price goes up to about $42.18 per megawatt hour. It's also important to consider that the cost for storing energy in batteries has been steadily decreasing, falling from $187 per megawatt hour in 2019 to $150 per megawatt hour in 2020 for a 4-hour discharge time, which benefits intermittent power sources like solar and wind. Even though nuclear power can provide stable electricity generation for the grid, these power plants are usually expensive and complex, legally challenging, and take longer to build compared to solar, wind, and hydropower. With an average construction time of 6 years and the issues regarding nuclear waste storage, there are some hurdles to overcome. New investments and progress in thorium and molten salt reactors make a compelling case for their potential benefits. However, there's still a long road ahead in order to verify how they'll perform in real life. So what do you think? Do you think thorium reactors will make an impact? And do you think we need nuclear as part of the energy mix at all? Jump in the comments and let me know. And thanks as always to my patrons, and welcome to new Supporter Plus members Randy Maybaum, Phil Stiller, and producer Josie Marie. All of your direct support really does help producing these videos and helps to reduce my dependence on the almighty YouTube algorithm. And speaking of which, if you like this video, be sure to check out one of the ones I've linked to right here, and subscribe and hit that notification bell if you think I've earned it. Thanks so much for watching. I'll see you in the next one.